So I'm going to assume we're good. Thank you, everyone, for listening in this morning. Thank you, Hannah, for helping me navigate all this. It's really, your help is appreciated. And can I please invite everyone to stop me, add their own two cents as I move through this. Remind me if I'm speaking too quickly, would be helpful. I hope to make this as friendly as I can. So I'm Mike Boza, and I work in the Career Center, but my job title is an employment counselor. The Career Center is room 10. It's in the main hallway, right next door to where everybody pretty much knows where Quinn is, and I'm in the office kind of next to Quinn. I'm only here part-time, so you're not going to find me all the time. And this screen tells you the days that I'm here. So Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, 9 to 12, although generally I'm here by 8 o'clock, and quite often I'm here till 1 o'clock. So, and it works best if I certainly invite you to stop by, but chances are when you do that, we're going to make an appointment so I can give you some really private time to chat with me to figure out what your job needs are and be most efficient with the time we spend together. So this morning, I'm going to talk to you about understanding your paycheck. And it's important that you do this because there's a lot of information on your paycheck that needs to be correct. And it needs to be correct because you certainly want to get paid in the correct way. But there's other information that gets shared with government pieces that are collecting taxes and whatever, and you want to make sure all of that is accurate. So understanding your paycheck is a big deal, and we're going to kind of walk through that a little bit. And again, you can stop me and ask for clarification or repeating as we go along. So one of the things that happens when you first get hired is there an understanding between you and your, I'm going to get my pointer up here. There's an understanding between you and the employer whether your job is full-time or part-time. And there's another screen that follows this with some other choices. But generally, full-time means that you're being hired for a 40-hour work week. In America, that's what is the standard for full-time employee, 40 hours of work a week. Now, that doesn't mean that an employer considers for that particular job and business that they may consider 35 hours to be full-time or maybe 45 hours. But let's understand together that typically 40 hours a week is considered full-time employment. And with full-time employment, as this line right here speaks to, that generally comes with benefits beyond what you're being paid. So once you're hired full-time, most businesses, and they don't have to do this, this isn't by rule, but most businesses offer you more benefits besides your pay. And that may include things like participating in medical insurance. It may include a life insurance program. It could include vacation pay. Those are all things outside of the pay that you're being promised for the hours that you work on that job. If you're not being hired full-time, that means you're being hired part-time. And part-time means anything less than 40 hours. So if it's 39 hours, you're a part-time worker. So all the way down to, you know, 10 hours a week is considered part-time. What's important to hearing that is that a lot of employers will work hard to make sure you're not working the 40. They'll keep it at 38 or 39. So that benefit package I talked about before doesn't kick in. Okay, so part-time generally speaking, comes without any benefits, where you only get paid for the hours that you're working. There's other ways that you can be hired, and that could be hourly. The most part-time work is hourly, but sometimes it's expressed as just that. Hourly workers only get paid for the hours that they are on the job. And in my example, I said, if you're getting paid $15 an hour and you work 10 hours a week, 10 times 15 equals $150 of pay. When you're being hired hourly, there's generally not a commitment from that business that every week you're going to be getting 10 hours of work, 15 hours a week, 20. It can vary a good bit, such that one week you're working 10 hours, another week you're working 20. And if you're really going to be dependent that that pay be a regular amount week to week, that's going to be challenging with that type of job. Some employers hired what's referred to as per diem. It's a Latin term, actually, diem, which means by the day. So a day is determined, or the pay is determined by each full day that you work. And some employers may consider the standard of an 8-hour workday, but some may say our day is 10 hours and they have a right to do that. And for when you work that full day, we're going to pay you a certain amount for the day. And so there's an example there that says $100 per day. If you work 3 days, that's $300. The other term you want to understand here is salaried. Salaried means that they're offering you a certain amount of money to be paid the same regardless of how much you work. So let's quick take a look at the example where they say $600 a week. That's whether you work 35 hours or 45 hours or 20 hours or 50 hours, the pay is the same. So $600 a week, if you're only working 35, that's terrific, isn't it? But if you're working 45, that's part of that obligation. We're going to give you a fixed amount of money every week. That suggests, regardless of how many hours you work. That salaried workers generally, when we move into that more professional employment, so most professionals are working with a salary. By the way, it's a good point to interject that as of December 31st of this year, so actually beginning that pay period following the 31st, there's a new minimum wage in New York, and that's $13.21. Right at the end of this month, starting December 31st, no one in New York State can offer you less pay than $13.21. All right, so one of the things that can vary once you've been hired is how often you're paid. There's a listing here of the choices that exist. So you can get paid on a daily basis. That's kind of rare, really difficult for employers to do because they need to provide an accounting of your pay on an every single day basis. But there are jobs where you're paid at the end of each day. More typical are the next two, which is weekly or monthly. Weekly, you get paid at the end of every work week. And biweekly, my belief is that most jobs these days are paying you every 2 weeks. Every 2 week cycle, at the end of every 2 week cycle, you're going to receive a paycheck. There are jobs that pay you monthly, where every 30 days you're going to get your paycheck. They're rare, just like daily jobs are rare. So when you get paid, that it's the obligation, and in New York State, it's actually a law that with your paycheck, and whether you're getting paid with an actual check that's given to you at the end of that pay period, or whether you're getting paid direct deposit. Do we know what direct deposit is? Where that money is sent right into your banking account. Either way, you need to be provided a pay statement, and pay stub is kind of shorthand, a short way of saying pay statement. That pay statement has to have some very specific information on it. It has to show the rate of pay that you're receiving, whether that be hourly or daily or your salary. That rate has to be shown on the pay stub. The number of hours or days that you work has to be shown there. The deductions that are taking out and the taxes that are being taken out of your pay have to be listed on the pay statement. You're going to see all this in a sample pay statement in another screen. And then there's other ways that you could be compensated. We talked about some of the benefits that you could be receiving. They all need to be listed there and shown if money is being taken out to account for those benefits. So there's three main sections for every pay statement. There's a section that shows how you're being paid. There's a section that's going to show the taxes that are being deducted. And there's going to be a section that shows other deductions that are being taken out, deductions other than taxes. Here's a sample pay statement. And on this statement, right, it's going to have the company's name. It's going to have your name listed there. This is really important. You want this to be very accurate. You want to make sure they have the right address down. So check your statement, because one of the things that happens is there's a reporting that goes to the government that shows your taxes and whatever that are being taken out. You want those deductions to be connected with the right name and address. So be sure they have your name spelled correctly. Be sure they have your address, city, state, all that down correctly. Every statement will tell the pay period for which you're being paid. In this case, in this example, this person is being paid every 2 weeks. It started on February 17th. The pay period ended March 2nd. This statement is being issued on March 2nd. That's a 2 week period. Then if we'll look down here, looks like this person is working full time because 40 hours a week times 2 weeks, they've worked 80 hours. And they were paid a pretty nice wage, right? $27. That's what rate means, the amount that you're being paid for every hour. So 80 hours times 27, this pay period, they're receiving $2,160. Quickly, let's look down below. Gross is an accounting of what you've made for the year to this point. So this $2,160 added to what you made previously in this pay year. So year to date, so from the beginning of this year, all the way up until this pay statement, they paid you this amount of money, right? Gross, the total for the year. This is gross for just this pay period, right? This is all this person has received for just this pay period. I'm going to show you another pay stub in a minute. It's a bit more complicated than this one that'll show where folks have earned other things that'll change this amount. And then this is the other section. This is where taxes are listed. These four taxes that are shown here, federal tax, state tax, a Social Security tax, and a Medicare tax are on every paycheck in America, right? Well, let me make one exception. Not every state has a state income tax. But this is certainly true for New York State. Everyone in New York State will pay these four taxes. Monies will be taken out of your paycheck every pay period to pay for those taxes, right? So this this amount of money in this example, $296.75 was taken out of this person's paycheck and sent into the federal government. We can talk more about that in a minute. $97 was taken out for state tax, taken out of this total, this gross number. Social Security, $81.41. Medicare, $28.10. We're going to talk more about those. Together, they're referred to as FICA. This is going to be on another slide explaining this. But those two amounts also come out of the $2,160. So they total these four tax deductions, right? Total deductions, and they put that number here. So your gross pay minus the $503 is your net. Net means the amount paid to you after deductions. This is the amount this person received in their pay that week. So, as a review of that, your pay includes the regular wages you earn, and that's, this is shown. Remember, we talked about your agreement. Are you being paid hourly, daily, or salary? So your wages are shown with all of that information by the pay period. Again, is it, are you being paid every week? Are you being paid every 2 weeks? Does it show, and that this wasn't true of the example I gave you, but are you being paid for overtime? That'll be showed there. Are you being vacation pay? That'll be shown there. Are you getting some sick pay? That'll be shown on that pay stub. And this is shown as your gross earnings for the year and net. Those two terms are important, gross and net. Again, to repeat, gross being the total before any deductions and net being the amount you're receiving after deductions. So gross earnings, right? Remember that? That total before deductions, year to date, the gross you've been paid, everything to this point, to this paycheck for this pay year, the total deductions being removed, and your net pay, the total you've earned after deductions. So let's talk a little bit about taxes a little bit. That's that section of your pay stub where federal tax, state income tax, and that piece that we referred to as FICA is taken out. That'll be on the next slide. So everyone in America pays federal income tax. It's a certain percentage of your wage that goes to the federal government. That money is used by the federal government to operate the federal governments. That's the money that pays for many of the roads in America. It pays for us being able to have an army and a navy. It pays for many, many, many of the programs that the federal government runs. It helps pay for education in America. It's a many, many, a long, long list of things that the federal government uses that money to operate with. And then there's state income tax. Pretty much every state has a state income tax. There's a couple of exceptions. Florida, I know as an example, doesn't have a state income tax, but New York State does. So a certain percentage of what you've earned comes out of your paycheck and goes to the state government, the government in New York. Now that money in New York is used to fund our road system. Much of our education is paid for by money that comes to, in our case, the Rochester City School District gets money back from the state to operate their schools. And again, there's a long list of programs that state money, state taxes fund in New York State. Now, interestingly, let me pause for a quick second. Both of these, at the end of the year, Everybody files tax returns. If you work and make money, you have to file a tax return. And this, let me go back. So when we get to the end of the year, the 12th month in this pay year, which is in fact, the pay year is January to December. In December, the total amount of money that you've made and the total amount that you've paid in taxes will be shown on your pay stub. And when you file your taxes, you want to make sure what was shown on your last pay stub matches what the government says was paid in taxes. And an accounting is done. Some of that money is going to come back to you. Depends where your income level is. Okay? So you may make $20,000 that year. Perhaps if you're a family that has three or four children, almost everything that you paid in taxes is going to get sent back to you. But if you're a high wage earner, making $60,000, $70,000, $80,000, $90,000, $100,000 a year, you may get some back, but not all of it. So I know it's hard to see those taxes being removed from your paycheck, but at the very end of the year, when you file your tax returns, there's some math that happens, and the government may very well be sending big amounts of what you paid in taxes back to you if you fall into those lower income levels where they really don't want you to be paying all of that tax. So let's talk about FICA. FICA stands for Federal Insurance Contributions Taxes. And that was these two, Social Security and Medicare. Together, those two are referred to as FICA. Everybody who works and pays taxes pays these two, Social Security and Medicare. Social Security is for your old age and retirement. You're buying insurance. Everybody pays the same amount, which is 6.2%. So regardless of whether you're a lower wage earner or a very high-end wage earner, that percentage is taken out of your pay. Right? So for you, that might mean, let's just say, for example, you're paying $62. In Social Security. A very high-end wage earner may pay $620. So it's a very fair tax, and all of this, in some fashion, comes back to you when you're older and ready for retirement. So you should feel good about that. It's a really good program in America. It's been in place for about 70 years. And it's meant to protect you so that you still have an income when you retired from working. And Medicare, similar to Social Security, is health insurance. So medical insurance that's paid to you, or not paid to you, that's given to you when you reach the age of 65. So everyone in America at age 65 receives, it's free. Not for everyone. Some very high wage earners going to pay a certain amount of money for Medicare. But most folks in lower to middle incomes won't pay anything for Medicare. And that's because you've been paying for it out of every one of your paychecks now. It's really a lovely thing when you get to be 65 that you're going to start to receive a check sent to you every single month to help pay your bills, income, and you're going to be receiving free medical care. Let me back up for Social Security. Again, as much as you pay in relates to how much you get at the end. So the sooner you start working and pay in, and the more that you make, right? That's 6.2%. The person who makes $62, the person who pays in $620, that $620 person is going to get more back in Social Security when they retire than the person who didn't pay in as much. So it's hard to see them come out of your paycheck when you're working really hard now and every dollar counts, but these are really good programs that you're grateful for when you get to be older and need to stop working. FICA, Social Security, and Medicare. Other deductions that may come out, and I'm going to show you another pay stub in a minute that's examples of that. So this generally comes into play more when you're working full time. The employer is going to offer you to be a partner in some type of medical insurance where maybe they're going to pay 20%, you're going to pay the other 80, maybe they're going to pay 80%, you'll only pay 20%. That's a can vary greatly from business to business. They can offer you disability insurance, life insurance, a lot of different things that get offered to you, generally done in partnership with that employer where they're paying a certain amount and you're paying a certain amount. There's things that are called special savings accounts. So there's health savings accounts and there's flexible spending accounts. And what's really nice about those is money can be taken out of your paycheck before taxes are paid on it. This lowers your tax payment on that week-to-week basis so that you can have money when you need it later in the year, in this case, in a health savings plan to help pay for perhaps some dramatic health problems have developed for you and you've got a health savings account that you can now take money out of. Or flexible savings accounts can be used for things like childcare, right? Businesses will also offer retirement accounts. So you've got Social Security, right? That's going to help you with retirement, but you may want more. So you're offered the ability to be paid into a retirement account. Often they're known as 401ks. Many of you may have heard of those. 401ks are investment accounts where you put money in for the purpose of leaving it there until you're ready to stop working and retiring so that you can have both Social Security to draw from and your 401k to draw from and have a nice income in your whole older years. So if you've chosen any of those and are partnering with any of those, they're all going to be shown on your pay stub, right? And let me refer now to, let's see, got to remind myself how to do this. Well, it's going to be hidden. Let me see if I can do it this way. Let me show you another pay stub. So this is an example of another pay stub, much more complicated than the earlier one that I showed you, right? There's the employer. There's the employee's name and address. Remember, we were going to check that to make sure it's accurate so that information is always being recorded and being sent to the right address. This one shows the pay period. Again, this is a person who's working, getting paid every week, right? So the 19th to the 25th is a 1 week pay period. There's the date that this pay stub and the check was being distributed. And it's telling you you're being paid for the 20 hours. Want to make sure that 20 hours matches your understanding, right? So this pay stub lists some benefits. So you have five unused 6 days, five unused vacation days in this pay period. You have a total in both cases of 90 and 99 available to you to draw from. Now, I don't typically see this in part-time employment. So typically, the whole sick days and vacation days piece comes only with full-time employment. And those are to be considered benefits. Generally, in If you're working part-time and you need to be sick, you're not going to be paid. All right, so now we move down to the accounting of your pay. And they've shown your regular pay for this person. They worked 5 hours, were paid at a rate of $25. Yes, yep. That 5 times 25, currently they're receiving $125. And to this point in the year, their regular pay is $125 total. So this must be a first paycheck for someone. I'm not sure what CA stands for, but meal break and the rate suggests that they worked or chose to work 5 hours during what would have been break time and got paid more because of it. So they probably raised their hand and said, I'll work during that break time. You're going to pay me more, $50 for every hour I work during CA meal break. So 5 times 50, they get paid $250. The total for that type of income for the year to date is $250. This person also received some sick pay during this pay period, right? So this right here is for this pay period. 5 times 25, there's the total for that. Some vacation pay was also accounted for in this pay period. Hard for me to explain why that's here, but I think they just want to give you an example of what those additional incomes could be during a certain pay period. So they received $125 of vacation pay. This total, right? That total is going to be this current right here, the $625. So when you add up all of these different pays that during this pay period, their total pay was $625. It's the same in this column as the year to date. That's why, right? This has got to be the very first paycheck for this person. They've listed out the taxes. Remember I said everybody's going to have federal income tax, Social Security, Medicare. I'm thinking ID in this must relate to this town, city, state income tax. And there's all of your taxes. They're all totaled out. Net pay, right? So this total, once they removed all of your deductions, and this is itemized down here, total pay $625, the taxes that were taken out, right? $124, other deductions. Here's the other deductions. They paid medical insurance. They paid a medical pre-tax that's probably for a savings plan. Those deductions were totaled $7,250. Your net pay, that's what you brought home in your paycheck, was $428. Make sense? Okay. Thinking everybody's piping up if they need to. All right, let me get back to the presentation. All right, so I'm kind of at the end. And I'd like to have you ask questions or clarification, teachers, anything you need to suggest. I've written down some questions myself. All right, let me go through what I'm asking. So a lot of folks will say, how do I see my pay stub, right? So it's a good question if you're being paid in direct deposit or electronically, where you're not being handed a check. That pay check is literally being transferred computer to computer right into your bank account. Sometimes a pay stub is given to you in a little mail slot you may have at work or handed to you, but quite often it's kind of your obligation to visit the home page of where you work and look for there's an employee page where you can go in and see that pay stub. So a little extra effort on your part because you don't have a paper copy to look at. It's going to be stored on the company's website and you're going to have to go there to look at it.
Hey, Mike.
Yes.
One question that popped up in the chat from Jenny's class.
Thanks.
One student asked, if I pay into Social Security for many years and I die before I retire, what happens to that money and do my children get the money?
That's a great, great question from an astute learner. Thank you. Yeah, if you're married, your wife's going to receive your Social Security. If she also works and collects Social Security, she'll get what's ever larger. She'll get survivor benefit for a period of time, and then she'll be able to receive your Social Security if it's larger than hers. If you don't have a spouse, your children can make that claim for your Social Security. And I said it particularly that way because there's a process they have to go through to claim your Social Securities. So it's not an absolute guarantee that they'll receive it, but there's a process they can go through that could make them eligible for it. Make sense? Complicated. Yeah. There's a very, very friendly Social Security website where all of these questions, and it is very friendly to use. When you get closer to Social Security age, you're going to want to get familiar with that. Problem is, you got to get older. Boo. Right? Do I have to save my pay stubs? Not really. They're good to look at. You know, you want to make sure employers make mistakes. They make mistakes all the time, right? You worked 15 hours and all, you look at your pay stub and they're only paying you for 12. You want to check your pay stub to make sure it's accurate for what you believe is correct for the hours and for that pay period that you work. But you don't really need to save them.
Can I, it's France. Hi, yeah. Everyone.
Hi, Fran.
I don't mean to contradict you, to interject, but yeah. Your pay stubs are really good if you need to have proof that you're working. To have proof of income for some reason, whether you get certain services or potentially like borrowing money, I believe, in certain programs to help assist like with buying a house.
Yeah.
And all of that. So I always say it depends if you should save your pay stubs.
You know what, Fran? Thank you for offering that. You weren't contradicting at all. It's a great, great point. Matter of fact, I'm one of those people. So
yeah.
You come to see me in the employment office and you've had some work experience somewhere, I'd like to see a pay stub so that I can use that as part of your history.
Yeah, because you need to say what you got paid somewhere. I don't remember what I got paid like 10 years ago in a certain job necessarily, the exact amount or whatever, if you have to put it. So that's a good point. You have to use it for job applications.
Super point, Fran. Yeah, super good point. And if you're being paid electronically, all of your pay stubs, generally speaking, are all kept on the website. So you can go in when you visit the employer website and the employment services tab there, and you should be able to see every pay stub. I think they need to keep them for 4 years. I think that's what the government tells them, that they need to keep that history for 4 years. So if it's not a paper stub, you should be able to go in to the electronically find it, print it out so that you have it, and they're kept there nicely for you. Thanks, Fran. Great point. All right. So how are the deducted tax amounts determined? Well, I talked about Social Security a little. Let me go back to that page real quick. So everybody pays Social Security, everybody pays Medicare, and everybody pays the same rate. So that rate for Social Security is 6.2%. You could do the math. You made $100, 6.2% of $100 is $6.20. And Medicare is at 1.4. I'm having a hard time seeing it on my screen. So you got paid $100, $1.40 from your paycheck is going to go. if you got paid $1,000, 6.2% of that is $62 is being taken from your check. That's universal. So that rate doesn't change whether you're a low income, middle income, or high income earner. Now, what's different about taxes is that in America, the best way to say this is the more you make, the more you pay. So this is also done on a percentage basis. How much is taken out? It's kind of complicated, so I don't want to make it more difficult than it is. But as an example, maybe a lower earner, 20% of their income in federal tax. A higher earner might pay 35%. And it's set up that way purposely because there's a belief that the folks who make more money in this country, the higher income earners, should pay more of their income. And that payment going into the federal and state government is being used to run government programs. So I can't quote you a number that you can go with, but that becomes obvious to you at the end of the year when you file your taxes. And so your pay and your pay stubs and the end of the year tax process that you go through clarifies all this about how much taxes you're actually paying. And most of us listening to this today are probably going to discover that they get money back from all that taxes they've been paying all year. Okay. How about any other questions? Audience, teachers, clarification?
This is France again. I have a question.
Yeah.
Just give us 1 second, please. Say it loud. Oh, okay, go ahead.
Good morning, sir.
Louder.
Good morning.
Louder.
Yeah.
I have a question.
Yes.
I'm working, but sometimes I'm a little confused with my pay.
Yes.
Like when you take a vacation.
Yes.
The amount they pay you. And usually when you're not on a vacation, the pay sometimes is not the same thing. And I still don't understand the why it's not the same amount.
Let me make sure I understand your question. So every paycheck for you does not look the same when they talk about vacation pay?
Yeah, like when I take like a vacation, like a 1 week off.
Okay.
My normal pay would be like, for example, like, 1,100.
Yep.
After the tax. But when I have a vacation,
yep,
I never get that amount. Probably will be like just 1,000 something after tax out.
Okay.
And I'm kind of confused with that. Why is that different?
Okay. So this isn't going to be completely true for everyone. Okay. But employers do not have to pay you the same amount that you get paid for your work week as they pay you for a vacation week.
Okay.
They're not obligated to have those two amounts be the same.
Okay.
So I'm going to suggest, I think it's more often true that if you make $500 a week in a regular work week, mm-hmm, typically you get paid $500 for your vacation week. But that doesn't have to be true. That's part of the agreement the employer makes with when you get hired. I'm going to ask you to go to your HR office. Do you know, everybody know HR?
Yes.
Teachers, you think we know HR?
HR, human, yeah, resources.
Human resources. That's the department where you work that does payroll, benefits. That's the office. That's the door you want to knock on if you have questions about your working experience. They were probably the same office for the people that hired you. So they do hiring, they do benefits, pay, all that happens in the human resources, short for that, HR office. And questioner, that was a really good question. Thank you for asking it.
So I'm I'm going to jump in just real quick, Mike. Is that good advice? Yeah. And then this student, I can tell from her shirt, and I know this already, she works for University of Rochester.
Okay.
So they may be giving you money for parking or for something you do when you're actually working. They might be compensating you for something. No, and
after the tip order.
No. It's the opposite, where they give you extra money when you're working. Like they might give you a parking stipend or something like that. So she's not, what he says.
So you're saying she's not receiving that because she's not there.
Right, because she's on vacation. She may not be getting like an extra amount, maybe, but you're going to check with your HR department.
Yeah. That's why I'm really glad you asked that question, because a lot of questions people are going to want to ask are very specific to the place they work. And HR is generally a very friendly place for you to go and get those questions answered. And this person who asked the question, working at the U of R Medical Center, they're great employers. They offer a terrific benefit package. Good place to work. Your pay stub is probably pretty complicated because they're listing many, many benefits and deductible areas on that pay stub. Thank you. Really good question. Thanks, France, for all the clarification. Anybody else? Yeah, please. Okay, last thing. When you see me in the hallway, say hello, Mike. I love that when people stop and say hello, introduce themselves, chance for you to practice your conversational English, meet another person in the building, and especially good to know me when you're ready to come and look for some work. Okay? All right, career